Thank you, praise team, again for assisting us in worshiping the Lord. Have your Bibles. You may want to just flip over to the book of Psalms, Psalm 119. Not really going to study this passage tonight, but I just want to draw your attention to a verse or two here as we continue on in our series of how to study your Bible. And begin to read in verse 33, Psalm 119. The psalmist says, "Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes, and I shall keep it to the end. Give me understanding, and I shall keep your law. Indeed, I shall observe it with my whole heart. Make me walk in the path of your commandments, for I delight in it. Incline my heart to your testimonies and not to covetousness. Turn away my eyes from looking at worthless things, and revive me in your way. Establish your word to your servant, who is devoted to fearing you. Turn away my reproach, which I dread, for your judgments are good. Behold, I long for your precepts. Revive me in your righteousness." Of course, Psalm 119, all but 2 to 3 verses mention the word of God. Draw attention to that. And we're studying how to understand, how to comprehend your Bible when you read it and to be able to understand what God's saying. And one of the things that the psalmist prays here is verse 34, "Give me understanding." Every time you come to your Bible, that would be a good prayer for you to pray. Lord, give me understanding. Give me insight. Give me understanding into its meaning. Because then he says, "Indeed, I shall observe it with what? With my whole heart." It's hard to put your whole heart into obeying something if you're not quite sure what God means or what God says, right? That makes sense? So it's important we know what God says and we be able to interpret that passage of Scripture and gain the understanding that God has for us. And that's sort of where we're going tonight. We've been studying about how to study the Bible. And then for the last 4 Sunday nights that I was speaking anyway, we were looking at an overall picture of the Bible. We went and tried to give you a walk through the Old Testament, then through the New Testament. And I don't know how successful I was in giving you an overall understanding, but I did that because it's important that you have a view, right, of the whole 66 books of the Bible. So that when you're reading any one book, you can bring in understanding from other books of the Bible and be able to fit the whole together. We studied the first step in Bible study, which was simply observation, just looking at a text and seeing what is there, asking God to open my eyes that I may behold wondrous things in your word. And asking certain questions like, who's involved here? Who's it talking about? If you went to Daniel chapter 1, I don't know if you're familiar with that, but who would be in Daniel chapter 1? Daniel would be in Daniel chapter 1. And then he had 3 friends, right? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And so who's there? And there was the eunuch that was looking over them and going to discern what they got. There was the king. All those characters, that's who's involved in the passage. We talked about what's happening there in the passage. If you did that with Daniel chapter 1, what's happening? Well, the king has taken Daniel and his friends and a number of others from other countries even and brought them into captivity to Babylon. And then he's going to train them to be his advisors and wise men and all of that. Where was it happening? Well, it was in Babylon. He's away from home. And all those things give you insight, right, to understanding what's going on in the passage and what God is trying to say. And it's good to use a map at that stage. When did it happen? Well, we know it was sometime after 606 BC, because that was when the first of the captivities where Nebuchadnezzar came and carried Israelites into captivity. So it's sometime after that, and it's during that 70 years of captivity that these events are happening. So that helps you to fit it into a calendar, if you will. Why did it happen? Well, we know why they're in captivity, right? Why? Because of sin. They disobeyed God's laws. They didn't keep the Sabbath like God had told them to keep the Sabbaths and all those things. And then you have to answer the question for yourself, well, so what? What's that have to do with me? Well, as you read Daniel chapter 1, and that Daniel, even in that setting, did something significant, right? He determined in his heart that he would not what? He wouldn't defile himself. Even in a pagan society, he was not going to defile himself with the things that they offered to him. He was going to keep his heart pure before the Lord. Does that say anything to us in an impure, as we said this morning, an evil age, an evil world that we live in? Says a lot to us today. So that's the observation part that we were talking about. And then tonight we want to move on, Lord willing, here to our next step in Bible study. And that's interpretation. There's a passage over in Nehemiah where Nehemiah had come back and they built the wall and all of that. And then he's trying to solidify the people to follow after God. And he has Ezra come and gathers the people into, think of it as the town square. And he sets up a platform and a pulpit and the whole thing. And Ezra's standing there and it says he's reading to the people from the Word of God. And then he does something very interesting. It says he gave them the understanding of it. Another one in the same verse, verse 7 and 8, it says that he gave the sense of it. Giving the sense of it is giving the meaning. This is what God is saying to you. This is what he wants you to do with that. That's what I try to do every Sunday when I stand in this pulpit, is to give you the understanding, the sense of what is it that God is saying in a particular passage. And so we want to talk about that tonight and how you can do that and gain understanding into God's Word. There's another passage I want to draw your attention to. It's over in Acts in chapter 8. And there was a man by the name of Philip. And he was, among other things, an evangelist. And he was over there and he's preaching the gospel and multitudes are being saved. Huge crowds. And then all of a sudden the Spirit of God calls and says, listen, I want you to go out into the desert. There's a guy out there I want you to talk to. Now, Bob, if that had been you and you're speaking to a great big crowd, thousands of people are getting saved, and God says, go over here, you'd have kind of said, uh-huh, what? Lord, you can find somebody else to take care of that guy. I'm busy with the multitudes. But no, Philip responds, led of the Spirit, goes out into the desert, runs into the Ethiopian eunuch from down in North Africa, and he finds that he's reading. Now, if you get on the airplane sometime and somebody's sitting there reading Time magazine and you sit down beside him and say, do you understand what you're reading? That guy might pop you right in the cheek, right? It's insulting. But Philip says the Ethiopian eunuch, because I think he has insight into what's going on in this man's head through the Spirit. He says, do you understand what you're reading? And that man says back to him, how can I accept someone what? Someone helps me. Somebody guides me in the study of the Scriptures. That's what pastors are for, to some extent, is to guide you to understand the Scriptures, to gain their meaning. But I think we need to get to the place where you take up your Bible and you can get in there for yourself. That's our goal. In all these weeks, we've been studying about the Bible and how we got it and how to study it and all these things, is to you to come to the place where you can gain understanding and blessing and joy from understanding the Scriptures of God. And the Ethiopian eunuch, even though he's an unsaved man at this point, was already involved in the work of interpretation of the passage. Because he asks a question to Philip that shows that. He says, I've been reading this passage and I don't quite understand it, but he said, can you please tell me, who is the prophet talking about? Is he talking about himself or somebody else? That's perceptive, right? That only comes from the Spirit of God. Natural man didn't come up with that. That's God beginning to open up his heart. And God brings Philip along at just the right moment, climbs up into the chariot, asks him what he's reading, gets the question, and it says that Philip went on from that place to do what? He began to preach Christ from that passage of Scripture in Isaiah, to open up that man, and he became a believer. Later on in the passage, he's what? He's baptized. And really, that moment of interpretation opened up all of Africa to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Significant moment. What was involved? The interpretation of the Scripture, giving the sense, the meaning of God's Word. So what we're talking about tonight, is it important? It's of vital importance that we, first of all, understand this. Can anybody understand it? I remember my Uncle Murray, who was here this morning, coming to my house and sharing the gospel with my dad on numerous occasions. And he'd take him to scripture after scripture, and I'm sitting there soaking all this in, and he didn't realize it, but he's preaching the gospel to me. And my dad would say to him every single time that he came and he shared the gospel, and this happened probably 50, 75, 100 times. My dad would always say to him, "Well, that's your interpretation." Anybody ever heard that said before? That's your interpretation. Listen, I want to tell you tonight, granted, you may have your interpretation, you may have yours, but you need to understand this. There is one biblical interpretation of a passage. There's one truth that God has there for us, and we need to work and work at it until we figure out what that is. Now, you know what? I've been a pastor for 38 years. Bob's been a pastor, I think, for 150 years. And there are passages that he and I don't understand fully yet. But guess what? When I started out, I didn't start understand hardly anything. And God has taught me a fair amount over the years. I'm still scratching the surface, but what am I doing? I'm growing and learning. And there's passages that when I started out, I didn't understand at all, that now seem fairly simple. I don't understand why, Jared, you don't understand them. As we grow, as we learn, we grow in our ability to interpret the passages of scriptures that God before us. So what I'm saying is don't give up, don't quit. And even what I'll teach you tonight, they'll give you some guidelines, maybe some guardrails to keep you safe in the interpretation of scripture, but you're not going to understand everything. You may be a little bit like the preacher was sitting in a restaurant and eating, and an atheist came in and thought he'd have some fun with them, and he says, "Well, preacher," he says, "you got that Bible all figured out yet?" And the preacher looked up and said, "No, I don't." He said, "You mean to tell me there's things in there you don't understand?" He said, "Yeah, there's things in there I don't understand." He said, "Well, what do you do with the things you don't understand?" He said, "Well, it's sort of like this fish I'm eating." He said, "I eat the meat and I put the bones over here." He said, "The things I don't understand are like those bones." And they said, "I leave them over there for people to choke on that want to." Well, you can go ahead and waste your time choking on the bones, or you can feed on the things that God has given you understanding to and begin to add to your understanding and grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, what is interpretation? Interpretation is understanding that God gave us a revelation. How many of you have ever read the Bible and you thought, "Oh, I just don't understand it. It's like a puzzle that's got too many pieces," right? And you feel frustrated. Can I tell you tonight, God didn't give you a puzzle. God gave you a revelation, and the point of a revelation is that he wants you to understand it, and he wants you to understand it more than you want to understand it. He's not about trying to hide the meaning from you, but listen, he's not going to give it to you if you're outright lazy. He wants you to do a little bit of work and digging, right? For the gold, the treasure that he's hidden here in his word, that we'll dive into it and we'll study it and we'll listen to messages from other people and we'll read books and we'll read the Bible and until we get the meaning of a passage, the actual meaning of the passage. Let me try and illustrate it a little bit. I have trouble sometimes distinguishing between certain colors. I'll put something on, my wife will say, "What are you doing wearing navy pants with that shirt?" I say, "Well, I thought they were black, and I thought black went with anything." But we have this sometimes a little, not a bad disagreement, but just a little agreement about it. And so I'll put something on, and she'll say, "Well, I really like that blue sweater on you." I said, "I didn't know it was blue." You know, we kind of go through that bit of a stupid stuff, and it's kind of like biblical interpretation. Somebody sees it this way and says this. Somebody sees it this way and says that. And two people will look at the same verse and sometimes come up with two completely different interpretations, which only tells you what? One of them at least is wrong. They may both be wrong, but at least one of them, because there can't be two interpretations. There can only be one interpretation. There may be many applications of a passage, but there's only one solid interpretation of what God intends to be said in that passage. And so we want to get you to the place where you can begin to understand the interpretation of God's word. Now, sometimes the reason we disagree on what the interpretation is that we bring our own opinions to it and our own biases. We Baptists wouldn't have any biases, would we, when we turn to Scripture? But, you know, a Pentecostal, when he comes to the passage, and I'm not condemning him, I'm saying, but he comes to a passage with certain biases about the way he's going to interpret it. And I'll come to it, and somebody that's a Calvinist comes with one bias, and somebody that's an Arminian comes with another bias to the Scriptures, right? What we need to be careful is that we don't get caught up in our biases, but we come with an open mind to say, God, I just want to understand, what are you saying here? I want your truth. Grant to me the understanding of the passage. And that's our task when it comes. Somebody said that interpretation, it's like trying to think God's thoughts, right? That he's put here in his word. After all, there's only one author of your Bible. I know we say Paul and Peter and Isaiah and all these guys, but who's the author? It's the Holy Spirit. It's the one that's superintended the giving of all the Scripture. It's breathed out from God into these people, and it's our job to try and attempt to understand that. And so we try to get into the head and the mind of God, if you will, and sometimes into the head and the minds of people. Like, we've been studying Galatians on Sunday morning. We've been trying to get into Paul's mind and the situation he was looking at and the dangers that were there, that they should fall for some other gospel, which was not another gospel. All those things that we were looking at this morning. Let me tell you that the biggest step to interpretation is doing proper observation. If you just open up your Bible anywhere, flip it open, begin to read, and say, okay, I'm going to interpret this, you're almost invariably going to make mistakes. You're going to come up with some error. Because you need to take the time to observe what's there, who's involved, what's the situation, what's the context, all of those things that we'll talk about a little bit more tonight, if time permits. But we need to ask God to guide us carefully in our observation of the text. Take the time to do that. Somebody has said, the more time we spend in observation, the more accurate will be our interpretation. The less time we spend in observation, the less accurate will be our interpretation of a passage. Do you get that? So if you're lazy and you don't bother to do the work of observation, what are you going to make? A lot of mistakes. You're going to walk away and say, oh, God said this or God said that, or he may not have said that at all, because you just didn't take the time to observe what God actually said. Didn't put yourself into the passage the way that you should have. Why do we have to interpret a passage anyway? Why don't you just read it and bang, it should be plain and simple? Well, because time and distance and all those things have thrown up barriers to you understanding sometimes what a passage says. For example, there are language barriers, right? We don't open up and, okay, the Greek says this, and the Hebrew says this, the Aramaic says this, because the Bible's written in all three of those languages. So there's a bit of a language barrier. And even when you pick up your English Bible, you got to be careful, right? Because even in our English translations, words change. Like, the old King James talks about conversation. We think conversation is when Kevin and I sit down and have a chat. Conversation was your whole lifestyle when that passage was translated into the King James Version. So even then, you got to think about the language, and it can be a barrier that you need to be aware of when you're trying to figure out what's the interpretation of a passage. There are cultural barriers that affect why things were said and what actually happened in a passage and what's recorded. So you need to be prepared to do the work of figuring out what was going on in the culture back then. Sometimes it's a simple thing about their dress or the food that they ate, or the sacrifices they offered, that opens up a passage to give you understanding of what was happening. Jesus gave simple illustrations about what was going on in the field, and the sower sowing seed. And, you know, if you picture it today with our big combines and all those sort of things, you may not get the proper picture. You need to go back into the passage and figure out what's the picture that's there that I need to look at. What was the culture like back then? There are literary barriers that you need to be aware of. You don't read all Scripture the same. I just read yesterday through the book of Song of Solomon. You might have oceans. And as I read through that, it just clicked in my mind. You know, I don't read that passage the same way that I read the book of Romans. Romans is a well laid out theology. There's a logical process of thought. That's not what the Song of Solomon is. You can't read it that same way. And, you know, looking at every word and figuring out, well, this means this and that and so on. It might not lead you to the right direction in the Song of Solomon. When you're reading poetry, like in the Psalms, and you've got to keep in mind, what am I reading? Is it a historical passage? Is it a biographical passage? All those things come and bear light on the interpretation of a passage. There are communication barriers that we face. We face one tonight. I'm trying to communicate with you what's on my mind, and I'm not sure what you're hearing. It's like the cartoon I saw, Far Side, where the guy's talking to his dog. What man says is the caption, and then the man says, "Ginger, you've got to stay out of the garbage. I don't want you in the garbage anymore." Then over here, it says what the dog hears. What the dog hears is blah, 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 blah. My fear tonight is that as I'm up here trying to say some things to you, what you're hearing is blah, 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 blah. Because sometimes we fail to communicate. When God communicates to us, God's thoughts are so much higher than our thoughts, right? That it's difficult. We've got to do some work here to figure out sometimes what is it that God's trying to say to us. There are barriers to communication. There's even individuals that love God. I mean, we can be sitting together as deacons at a meeting and we're discussing a certain thing and somebody says something and somebody else kind of jumps on that and he says, no, wait a minute, that's not what I was saying. And then they don't let him explain what he was saying and somebody else says something else. And before you know it, you've got total misunderstanding. Why? Because there's a communication barrier that's there. We're not understanding what other people are saying. So you've got to take the time to understand what's being communicated to you from God and to work your way through the process. I will say, and I don't want it, I don't say this with the thought of don't try to read your Bible. I think every Christian needs to read their Bible. I just think that when you come to the Word of God, because it is the Word of God, you need to have this in the back of your mind. Handle with care. Handle it with utmost care. This is God's Word, His revelation to your heart and to your mind. And there are pitfalls that you need to avoid. People misread the Bible all the time. Simple little ways that they misinterpret the Bible. If Jesus says, "I am the way," but somebody else reads it, "Jesus says, I am a way," is there a difference? Big difference in what they read. But people do that all the time with the Scriptures. Sometimes they do it on purpose. In John 1, where Jesus says, or the Bible talks about Jesus, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Some people come along and distort it by saying the Word was a God. Totally different. There's only one God, and Jesus is that God. He's God manifest in the flesh. So we need to be careful. I can't say it enough. Learn to read. Learn to read carefully. Don't read carelessly the Word of God. Sometimes we distort the text. 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 16, Peter writes, "There are some points in Paul's letters," he says, "which are difficult to understand." I am so glad. I take comfort in Paul and Peter saying that. Peter's an apostle, and if he struggled with what Paul said, it's okay for me to struggle sometimes with what Paul says. What did he mean? All right? So it doesn't mean I'm a dummy. I'm just like Peter. I struggle to understand sometimes what Paul says. But he goes on to say this. He says, "And which ill-informed and unbalanced people," this is just one translation, "ill-informed and unbalanced people distort as they do the other Scriptures and bring disaster on their own heads." What I want to point out there is this, that when you distort and you're not careful with the Scriptures, Peter says what you're going to do is you'll bring judgment on your own head. So you need, when you're handling the Scriptures, not to be jumping to conclusions and not to be flying in the face of a Sunday school teacher and say, "Oh, you got that all wrong." You need to be a little bit humble here and realize, you know what? I need to carefully read this passage. I need to understand what it is that God's saying in this passage. And maybe I've gotten to the place where I'm distorting it. If you find out that your interpretation of a passage is contradicting another passage, you got a problem, because there is no contradiction in Scripture. I stand by that. But I will also say this, there's times where I read the Bible. You ever find this, Graham? You read something and it seems like it contradicts something over here. And it may be 10 years down the road that suddenly somebody says something or I read something. Oh, now I get it. There's no contradiction. I understand that. You need to be prepared to say, I'm not going to understand it all. There may be apparent contradictions at times, but we know this. With God being the author, there will be no contradictions in His Word. Come to the text with that understanding. We need to understand that we have somebody that wants to misinterpret the text. For example, back in the garden, we talked about this. Satan comes to Adam and Eve, and he says, has God said, right? Did God really say that? What's he doing? He's contradicting the Scriptures. If you come up with an interpretation that contradicts something over here, you better be very careful that you're not contradicting. You're not just contradicting Scripture, you're contradicting the author of the Scriptures. So you need to be careful and work that through and figure out what is it that God's actually saying in this particular passage. People have used the Word of God to do horrible things. People have used it to use Scripture to try to wipe out the Jews. They've used it to enslave the blacks. They've used Scripture to do a lot of things that should never have been done. Sometimes we get involved in subjectivism with the Scripture. You say, what in the world is subjectivism? Let me try and just simply explain that for you. We subject it to our own way of thinking and seeing things. We read a passage and we get this little quiver in our liver. We got a feeling. Oh, I got this feeling when I read it, so this is what it must mean. I don't care what your feelings are. If it doesn't line up with proper interpretation of Scripture, you probably just ate too much pizza. All right? So don't allow those things to misguide you, mislead you in your studies of the Word of God. A lot of people are subjecting the Scriptures to what's called relativism today. They're saying that, well, you know, it meant something back there, but it doesn't mean that anymore. It means something different today. No, the Bible always means what it intended to say. We may apply it in a little different way here, but God's saying the same thing, and you need to understand that when you come to a passage of Scripture. I'd say one more error you need to avoid is this: overconfidence. The Bible says this, much knowledge puffs up. It'll make you arrogant. And what I've found is a lot of Christians, when they get a great head knowledge of the Word that hasn't been transformed into their hearts, they get very hard and harsh and arrogant about what they believe. God never intended that to happen with His Word. If you find that happening in your heart, you need to back up and say, okay, what's going on here in my own heart and in my own life as I come to the Scriptures? I got a few minutes left, so I'm going to continue on. I want to give you 5 keys to understanding and interpreting the Scriptures, the Word of God. Number one principle for studying the Word is what I'm going to call content. The content of the passage. The basic principle of content is the observation of the passage gives you the content, right? That's where the content comes from, is you look at the words, you look at the people, you look at the scene and what's taking place and put it all as you ask your questions and you figure out what's going on in the passage. What do I see? So spend time in the observation of the Scriptures. Remember the old spiritual, it says this, the knee bone's connected to the thigh bone, the thigh bone's connected to the hip bone's connected to the tailbone. And now you hear the what? The Word of the Lord. Now, that's primitive physiology, but it's good methodology, because what it's saying is that our bodies are connected, right? And when it brings that to the Word of God, what it's saying is all the Word of God is connected. You don't disconnect Genesis from everything else that's in your Bible. You've got to look at everything else in the Bible in the light of what Genesis says and Exodus says and Romans says and Revelation says to draw in the meaning of the passage. I'm going to jump to the second one just for time's sake tonight. Not only the content of a passage, getting informed as to what's there, reading the passage. When I'm preaching, for example, on, on Galatians chapter 1, the first thing I'll do is sit down and read the passage at least five times. I have a little notepad there, and I'm jotting down a word that'll stand out, a name that I'm, you know, things I want to go look up in a dictionary or somewhere to find out a little more what that's talking about and find out the tense that's there and that type of thing, because it gives me understanding. I'm figuring out the content that's in the passage. And once I've got the content down, then I want to figure out what's the context. That's the second important thing that we want to look for. The principle of context is that which comes before and that which comes after. If I stand up here tonight and I say to you, I want you to understand this, folks, you've been deceived, because I read in my Bible week this week in Psalm 53, the Bible says there is no God. Is that true? It's in the Bible. But you better read it in its what? Its context. What's the context? The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Makes a big difference. Now that's sort of simplistic, but I just wanted to get the idea across to you. When somebody says, oh, the Bible says that, and it sounds a little funny, right? It doesn't sound quite right. You need to say to them, you know, if two guys show up at your door and try to tell you something, you need to say, oh, well, would you read the few verses before that, and would you read a few verses after it? That almost always solves most of the things they're trying to deceive you with. Reading the passage in the light of its context, the verses that precede it, the verses that go after that, give you a greater understanding of what it is that God is trying to say to our hearts. And most of the cults that we have in the world, especially they're related to Christianity, got started because somebody ripped a verse or two out of a context. They just took it completely out of its context. Excuse me. And we get into so much doctrinal error because we do that. We just take one verse. It's like flipping my Bible over, putting my finger down, and it says that Judas hanged himself. And flip another verse, put my finger down, and it says, go and do thou likewise. All right? That's not what God intended for you to do. It's there. Right? It's there, but that's, you're reading it out of its context and what it was saying in relation to our lives in those passages. I remember going into my grandmother's house years ago as a young child, and the place where I could evidently read, because I looked up and she had this placard that was always on the wall that said this, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. I remember reading that and filled with fear and trembling because I knew enough. I knew enough, but not enough. I knew enough that it scared me because I knew I couldn't work out my own salvation. I tried. I was living on that old thing because I've been taught it in the church I went to, good works, bad works thing. I talked about that this morning. And in that context, working out your own salvation, hey, you gotta do what? You gotta earn your own salvation. You gotta work it out. It wasn't until years later that I realized that it was said within a context. And it says that God is working out what God has worked into you, both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Does that make a difference? Made all the difference in the world. This salvation I'm to work out is not one that I worked for. It's one that he's given me, and I just need to work it out in my life. I need to work it out in the holiness of my day-to-day life. I need to let God change me through his word. So, understanding that there's a context to everything that is said will keep you from making mistakes in understanding the passages that are in God's precious word. Read it with care. Now, we talked a little bit about this. I'll just throw it out again. But when you're figuring out a context, there's different contexts. There's literary context. Am I reading poetry? Am I reading a doctrinal dissertation that Paul's put in here? I need to get the literary context. The literary context, if I'm reading Acts 1:8, there's a context to that passage. The disciples came and asked Jesus, when's all this going to take place? And afterwards, he ascended back into heaven. That's the context, right, of what happened in that passage. Does it have an import onto what says in that passage? Absolutely. And my understanding of that passage comes to bear by understanding the context of the passage. Any individual passage in a book, usually there's a paragraph, right, that relates to that verse where it's set in the scriptures, whether it's in Romans or Galatians or some other book of the Bible. You're reading one verse. You need to understand, if I'm reading a verse out of Matthew chapter 5, there's a context there in Matthew chapter 5 that I need to understand it in. There's a context not just in the paragraph and in the chapter. There's a context maybe in that particular section of Matthew, but there's also a context in the whole book of Matthew. And then there's a context of the whole Bible, which again is why I took the time for Sunday nights to just try and walk you through the whole Bible so you have a little better picture of how things fit in to a particular passage of Scripture. So there's the literary context. There's the historical context. We just talked about Daniel and the historical context about it. It's taken place where? In captivity. They're in bondage in a foreign land. And so the context there relates to all of that. There's a cultural context that we need to take into. There's a geographic context. When you're reading a passage, you need to figure out, where is this happening? Is there mountains? You know, when the disciples in Mark chapter 4 are out there on the water of the Sea of Galilee, and there's a storm, and they're afraid. I mean, these are fishermen that have been used to the storms. You need to understand that Galilee was a place that was subject to sudden storms. We know that, right? By going back and studying the historical context and so on of that particular area and the geographical context of that passage. So we need that can shed light on different passages of Scripture. There's a theological context that you need to remember when you're studying a passage of the Bible. Let me try and simplify this a little bit. You need to ask yourself, okay, you're reading something about Noah. How much of the Bible did Noah know? Was Noah before the Ten Commandments? Yeah, so he didn't have the Ten Commandments. Was Noah before John 3:16? Yeah, he didn't have a clue about John 3:16. But sometimes I find even preachers reading it as if Noah knew all about John 3:16, as if he knew about the Ten Commandments and all of those things. You need to stop. If you're going to get a proper interpretation of Scripture, put it into its proper historical setting and say, what did this guy actually know? What did David know? How much of the Bible did he have? And understand that it's given progressively. Any of you ever been to a progressive dinner or supper? We used to do it with the teens when I was a youth pastor years ago, right, Brenda? And we'd do a progressive supper where we'd go to somebody's house and we'd have appetizers. We'd go to somebody else's house and they'd feed us a salad. And then we'd go to somebody else's house and we got the main meal, and then someplace else and we got dessert. Boy, I love dessert, just so you know. But it's progressive. God gave the Bible in a progressive way. They didn't have it all in Genesis. Got a little more in Exodus, a little more, a little more, a little more all along. And so it's important when you go to read the book of Jonah, how much did Jonah know? Right? Makes a difference in how you interpret that particular passage of Scripture, keeping that in mind in its theological context. Excuse me. If you were one to study Daniel chapter 1, and you want to figure it out in its theological context, what you would need to do, there's some help there in the Scriptures, go back and read 2 Kings. 2 Kings in chapters 24 and 25 and 2 Chronicles chapter 36 will give you the context out of which to understand Daniel chapter 1. There's a theological context that flows out of there. There's a third word I want to throw out for you tonight, and that's the word comparison. Comparison. You say, what's comparison? Comparison underscores the importance of having a good concordance. That statement should be up here for you. There are always other scriptures that will add to your understanding of a passage, give it real meaning, and furnish some additional light. Don't take one verse of scripture, seclude it from all other scripture. There's always other passages that will shed light, give illustrations, help you to understand what God's saying in another passage of scriptures. During the Protestant Reformation, there was a great cry. It was called Sola Scriptura, which means Scripture alone is our final authority for faith and practice. How many of you believe that? All right, we do. And And they, what they did is they said, the scriptures aren't just for a hierarchy like pastors and missionaries and so on. It's the word's there for everybody. It's available for private interpretation. But what you need to understand when he says private interpretation, it doesn't mean that we're subject to our own private interpretation, right? That the Bible says this, no scripture is of any private interpretation, that you can't subject it. And when it's talking about that, it's saying private from other verses of scriptures. Follow what I probably just confused you with all that, but I don't have the time to go back and explain it further. But what I want you to do is understand clearly, compare scripture with scriptures. You read something that Paul says, and you can find something that Peter says something about it, go read what Peter says about it. If John says something about it, read what John said about it. If you find something that Jesus said about it, bring that in. If you're studying the subject of marriage, Paul said some things, Jesus said some things. There's some things in Corinthians, there's some things over in Ephesians. You need to put it together to get a proper understanding about marriage. Don't just keep it to itself. And understand our goal is to come to an accurate interpretation of the scriptures. Compare scripture with itself. John MacArthur, if you've ever read or listened to some of his sermons, he very rarely will even use an illustration that's from current life. I've heard him preach on this. He says, almost all my illustrations I use are from the Bible. Because I want to use the Bible as much as possible to interpret the Bible. Now, I don't think that you necessarily have to do that. I think you can use illustrations from other places. Jesus certainly used illustrations that weren't necessarily in the Bible and so on. So I think we can do that. But what they're saying there, and I like this, is the priority of the Word of God in understanding the Word of God. Bringing different passages of Scripture to bear. Seeing it in the light of all of the Scriptures. Understanding that it is one book. Yes, 66 books, but it's one book with one author that we need to understand. To do this comparison of Scripture, it's great to have a good concordance. Whether it's a Strong's or a Young's, I would recommend either of those two. I use Strong's mostly for myself. But where you can take words and look them up and terms and see how this particular term, for example, the word belief, and how it's used here and how it's used here and how it's used here, Will it give you insight into what God intended to say when he uses the word believe? Sure it will. For example, Jesus said that he worked many miracles and that there were people that believed on him because of the miracles. But it also says that he didn't entrust himself to them. You know what it means? He didn't believe in them. Why? Because their belief was a superficial belief that was just based on the miracles. It wasn't really a belief that came from the heart. Let me try and illustrate what I want to say here. We'll say that Kevin comes to me and Kevin says, Pastor, I got this disease and evidently it's incurable. I think I'm going to die. And I say, hey, you know what? He tells me what it is. And I say, I have a friend in Ontario and he's a doctor and he's just discovered a cure for what you've got. Big smile comes over Kevin's face. I say, Kevin, do you believe that? Yes, I believe that. You're cured. Kevin, look at me. You got screws loose, Pastor. Because knowing there's a doctor in Ontario that has a cure isn't going to cure him, what's he got to do? He's got to get connected with the guy that knows the cure. He's going to have to go see him. He's going to have to take the medication or whatever he's discovered as a cure for what Kevin's got in order to be healed. You follow what I'm saying? So here's the people. They saw Jesus perform miracles. Yay, right. Hey, this is great. We want to be on that team. But they weren't necessarily believing in Jesus. You need to come to the place where you have this personal belief and relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. It has to be a personal belief. And if you take a concordance, look up the word believe, you're going to find all kinds of scripture that will show you what God meant when he said, I want you to believe. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Talks about belief. So a concordance can help you a great deal in those particular areas. When you look up the word equip, now I was reading in Ephesians chapter 4 and sharing this with the new members class and talking about how that Paul gives evangelists and apostles and evangelists and pastor teachers and so on to the church for the purpose of doing what? Equipping the church so that they can carry on the ministry. What's it mean to equip? Well, I got out my concordance and began to look it up, and I found it's used different ways in the Bible. For example, the same word equip is used when it says the disciples were sitting mending their nets. That's what the word equip meant. It means mending nets. Why? Because they went out fishing, they're pulling in the fish, it gets caught on rocks, it gets torn and ripped, and they sit and they fix it. They mend it so it becomes what? Becomes whole. I looked up another place where that same word was used and found out that it's a word that was used of the setting of bones. You went out, you fell down, you broke your arm, the doctor comes, he sets the bones back together, puts a cast on there, so when it's brought together, it can what? It can heal. That's part of what it means to equip. I found out in another place that it's used of outfitting a ship for a journey. Putting in all the supplies and stuff you're going to need while you're out there on the water. So you got stuff to eat and water to drink and all of those things. And doesn't that relate to the gospel, which equips us for this journey called the Christian life? Pastors are to do what? We're to mend some nets at times. We are to equip the ship at times, to equip you to go through the journey of life and face the struggles and so on that you're going to face. Sometimes we have to set broken bones. That's part of what it means to be a pastor. How do I know that? I got out of the concordance, and I checked how it's used, that word, in other places in the Bible. And so I want to encourage you, get a concordance. Use that in your Bible study and grow in your knowledge of the Lord. You'll be glad I'm going to skip a couple of stuff here. Number four, and I'll throw the next two out fairly quickly here, but the next one I want to look at is culture. The word culture. And the word culture has to do with we're seeking to understand, and life does not exist in a vacuum. It exists in a culture which teaches us how they did, what they do, and what they do and why they do it. Jesus said some words to a young man. He came up to Jesus, and Jesus said, "Follow me." And the young man said, "Lord, let me go and bury my father, and then I'll come and follow you." And you remember what Jesus said back to him? "Let the dead bury the dead." Doesn't that sound harsh? I remember for years having read that and thinking, well, that doesn't sound like Jesus. It seems harsh. Until I was reading where a Middle Eastern guy was talking about this passage, and he explained it from the context. He says, for me to say, let me go bury my father, doesn't even mean that he's dying. Father was healthy. What he wanted to do was to go back home and be a good son and take care of things around the farm until his father died, until he got his inheritance. And what the young man was saying to Jesus, I want to go back home and I'm going to stay with my dad until I get my inheritance and then I'll come follow you. Jesus says what? Forget the inheritance. I want you to follow me when? I want you to follow me now. Does that make a little more sense? Jesus is not quite so harsh when you understand it in the light of the passage, in the light of what? The culture. The culture sheds great light on what God's teaching us in the scriptures. When you read the book of Ruth, for example, and you think about the culture and the story that goes on there. We say, oh, it's a love story of Ruth and Boaz and all of that. But remember I said it needs to fit into its historical context. What's the historical context for the book of Ruth? It's the book of Judges. What was the book of Judges? It was probably one of the most godless periods of the whole history of the people of Israel. And the context means you ask yourself, did anybody live for God during that godless period? And Ruth says, yes. There was this Moabite woman that came to believe in God. And even in that wicked context where most of the Israel wasn't living for God, she did. And there was another man in Israel by the name of Boaz that was a man of God during that period. And they lived for God. The context, right? And the culture. Some people, I remember one pastor saying about the book of Ruth, sitting around a table with them a number of years ago. He said, well, that's kind of a sexy book. The book of Ruth, I think he was saying more about himself than anything. What he was referring to, because I picked him up on it, I tend to have that bad habit. And he was talking about when Ruth comes and she lays down at Boaz's feet, right? And he thought, he read something more into that. There's nothing sordid. There's nothing dirty about that. It was a cultural thing that she was doing. If you understand the culture, you don't misinterpret the passage. He misinterpreted the passage because he didn't bother to understand the culture that was involved in that passage. So just in understanding the book of Ruth, culture plays a big part. Just to give you, I was going to get a picture put up here of the Lord's Supper done by, what was his name? Leonardo da Vinci, right? Famous picture of the Lord's Supper. But what you need to understand, it's painted, beautiful picture, not against the artwork, totally out of the culture. It's painted with a 15th century culture. He has a 15th century painting in the background. He shows light outside the windows in that, if you look at it carefully, and we know the Lord's Supper took place probably late at night. So there's a lot there that's misinterpreted, even in the painting, about that passage of Scripture. I could go on and talk about that. For time's sake, I won't do that tonight. And let me just get to the last passage here, or last thing I want to talk about, and that is consultation. Don't get so arrogant that you think you can do it better than anybody else and you can do it by yourself. I've done it for 38 years. And I'll sit down and I work my way through a passage and I do the work of observation and I'll do the work of interpretation as best I can. But I want you to know this. I have about 3,000 books in my library for a reason. I have a lot of commentaries. And I believe this, that the Spirit of God has spoken to other men before me. And in order to keep myself from getting off into error and mistakes, I'll always check what I got out of that passage with what some of these other guys that I've come to trust. There's some of them I don't trust, but I've come to trust. I know where their hearts are coming from. I know that they've accurately studied the Scriptures and the Spirit has given them. I tell people this. I can see further when I'm standing on these guys' shoulders than I can standing on the ground on my own. And so I believe that I can learn from what other men, right? Now the problem is, and I'll warn you here, the problem in our day is that too many people are jumping to the commentaries first before they ever get into the Word. And a lot of people follow one man. Somebody asked me the other day, who's your favorite commentator? I said, don't have one. No, come on, you got one. I know you got one. No, I don't have one. I say, if I'm checking out a passage, I'll look and see what MacArthur says, but I'll also look over here and see what this guy says and this guy says and this guy says. I'm studying through the book of Galatians right now, and I've probably got 10, 12, 15 commentaries just on the book of Galatians. Why? Because I want to do it carefully. I don't want to make a mistake. I don't want to teach you wrong. If I can possibly prevent that, I'm going to do everything I can. And so at least start out and get yourself a good, even a one-volume commentary on the whole Bible. Start out with something like that. And if you want some ideas, I can show you some of my library that I have and give you some direction there. But I don't want to take the time to get into it too much in depth tonight. But get yourself some help, right? Nothing wrong with checking it out with scholars that have studied before you. And it's kind of sad to say, but I've talked to a few people lately, and I'll say, but they'll say something about this passage. I think it says this. And I say, but you know, so-and-so says this. Well, I don't care what he says. I feel. You ought to be awful careful when you get so arrogant that what you feel is more important than what the Word of God says. And people that have studied the Word of God and have a heart for God and a heart for the Word of God, you do well to do what? Pay attention to what some other people are saying about the passage so you don't get yourself into trouble. Anyway, I'm going to stop. I thought you'd all say amen, praise the Lord at that point. I hope what I've given you tonight will genuinely help you as you try to open up your Bible for yourself. I'm not trying to overwhelm you tonight. I don't want you to think, hey, I can never interpret the Scripture. I got to do all this. But I think it's only right that I tell you there's some safeguards. There's some things that will help you to properly understand the truth of God's word. And understanding God's truth is absolutely vital. That you don't distort it, you don't misinterpret it, but you get God's truth. Get to the heart of it. Take the time to do it. I'll tell you this, it's worth your time. And there's great joy. I find so many times, I find something in the word and it just, I get excited about it. It brings joy to my heart. The truth that I shared with you this morning when we came to the Lord's table about God telling the Israelites, you know what? All those sacrifices and stuff that you offered in the Old Testament, he said, it wasn't for me. I didn't need your bulls and goats. I wasn't hungry. It was for what? It was for you. It was to teach you about God. And then God related that to me to the Lord's table. It's not so much for God. It's for who? It's for us. We need to come to that table. We need to remember him. I want to tell you, there was a joy came to my heart when God taught me that this week and showed me that truth from his word. And you can know that joy in the word of God. And I want you to have it. Graham, would you just, we'll just close with a word of prayer instead of a song tonight.